Yes guys, so let's deal with the new topic, corporate restructuring. Now, what does corporate restructuring actually include? Corporate restructuring includes, first part of it is called as absorption. The second one is amalgamation. Next comes your reconstruction. And another broad part dealing with demerger. These are my parts as far as your corporate restructuring is concerned, which can be broadly divided. Well, there are other things, even your buyback comes under corporate restructuring. And other than these processes, there can be any normal restructuring. Let's say, for example, one person is only into wholesale business. Another person is doing a business of only retail. So the wholesaler wants to take over the retailer so that he can use his retailing facilities. So let's say he has taken only 80% of the shares of it and has made it as a subsidiary and starts doing business on a both wholesale as well as a retail basis. It also qualifies for a corporate restructuring process. So whenever we are talking about corporate restructuring, the ambit of this chapter is very, very vast. So let's discuss in parts what each one is talking about. Giving you a brief framework of what an absorption means, we can say that an absorption process, one company, let's say A, is taking over B. Then I call it as a corporate restructuring process. Whenever A takes over B, B is basically called as my selling company. And A is called as purchasing company. What is A purchasing? What A purchases is B Limited's net assets. All the assets and liabilities of B Limited get transferred to this company A Limited. In any transaction, whenever there is a transfer of net assets, then definitely there should be some consideration in return which A has to pay to B. And this consideration we call it as purchase consideration. At the end of the absorption process, always remember that your selling company always gets liquidated. When you're talking about an absorption process, your selling company always gets liquidated. So, what purchasing company pays to the selling company is called as purchase consideration, and what the selling company transfers to the purchasing company is called as their net assets. Now, how is amalgamation different from absorption? Amalgamation, I can call it as double absorption. Because two companies, let's say I am taking A as well as B, both are coming together to form a new company that is C Limited. If you break it into two parts, A with C and B with C, I can say each case is an absorption process. So what basically happens? This A and B are called as selling companies. C being the purchasing company here. A and B transfer their net assets to C, and C transfers to both A as well as B something called as purchase consideration. In short, we call it as PC. Again, always remember that the selling company gets liquidated. So the same thing what we are discussing in both absorption as well as amalgamation. Absorption, where I am talking about only two, involving two companies, here I am involving three companies. So a double merger is happening. A is merging into C as well as B is merging into C. So both mergers put together, I can call it as amalgamation process. Absorption process only involves two companies, one purchasing and one selling company. When we come to this process of restructuring, is reconstruction. Reconstruction is only for loss-making companies. A company which is continuously incurring losses, they opt for this reconstruction process. Reconstruction process can be split into two parts. External reconstruction and internal reconstruction. What is an external reconstruction and an internal reconstruction? Basically, whenever I have a loss-making company, the first thing the management has to do, the management needs to make a corrective action to bring it into profits. Let's say the management could not square on something to identify, to be identified as a deficiency in their business plan. They could not identify the deficiency. So even if they are continuing the business with the current business plan, then definitely they are going to incur losses. The management is not competent enough to continue the business anymore. If that is what they reduce from that, then what happens? This A company, if it is a loss making company, will go to B Limited, will approach B Limited and say, you take over my company. Take over my company because I am continuously making losses. You staying in the same industry have been making continuous profits. So you are competent enough to bring my company into profits. I have no such competency. I have been making continuous losses. I want to go out. So this A Limited now will be called as selling company. This is the company which was continuously making losses. B being the purchasing company will acquire net assets from A and it pays something in return to B, which is called as PC. Now, though these transactions both look identical, having a purchasing and a selling company, net assets being transferred and PC being received, understand there's a basic difference is not with the nature of the transaction. The basic difference is how the restructuring process, reconstruction process went on. Now, whenever I'm talking about restructuring for absorption process, I never said that they are a loss-making company. It is basically one company going and taking over the other for whatever needs it may be. Let's say they wanted a higher major, you know, market share. A had only a market share of 14%, B had a market share of 9%. So they thought, once I acquire B, I'll get 23% market share. For a higher market share, let's say they went and acquired. Or they wanted to venture into B Limited's, you know, new scale of business or new line of business, then they have acquired. Now such principles are lying as far as your absorption is concerned. But whenever I come to external construction process, the first motive comes out from loss making company. Since they are continuously making losses, they want to sell their organization since they do not have sufficient competency to bring them into profits. So there comes in your reconstruction process, which is external. That means I am reconstructing with the help of some other company. That is called as external party. So that external party, whenever it is involved, we call it as external reconstruction process. Observing both the same and your accounting principle of substance over form, I can say that both the transactions are similar now. Because for us, accounting purpose, we only look at substance, not the form of the transaction. Form is different, correct. But the substance of the transaction is B Limited being taken over by A or A Limited being taken over by B. Net assets being transferred and PC paid as consideration. As simple as that. So always whenever we talk about substance over form, both the transaction as far as my accounting purpose is concerned will be treated the same. There is no distinguishment between how the, you know, the actual process came up, be it an external reconstruction or my absorption. Now what happens with an internal reconstruction? Internal reconstruction is also mooted from a loss making company again. Continuously making losses, he wants to bring out into profits. Now, how can he bring out into profits? Let's say there's a change in the business plan. Let's say, for example, Basics, a clothing store which had retail outlets in India at multiple places, understood that having a retail outlet, they have been making continuous losses. Reasons are better known because you have a rental cost to be incurred, electricity cost to be incurred, staff charges to be incurred, so much of cost he had to incur. And he tried to continue the business for about 4-5 years. he made continuous losses. Then there was an internal reconstruction process which went on so that they analyzed the entire business plan and they have understood that their business model has to be changed to bring them into profits. So what is the change that they brought in? They have made it into a website now. They do not have any retail outlets outside. So what they are doing is they are only doing their trade through a website. So first thing that they cut down is on the rental expenditure, staffing, electricity. All they need now is a small godown, one website to be maintained and delivery people. That's it. Story ends there. So they are trying to bring out profits in a different business model itself. But understand, to implement the business model, all of a sudden, you incur a lot of expenditure. The first thing, whenever you have already rented premises, such rented premises, if you exit, again, whatever deposit that you paid will be forfeited. Now, first thing, that forfeiture expenses I have to bear. Next, the website developing charges. Again, how I have to completely construct the website, consulting for it. Now, all this expenditure is really incurred to get into this internal reconstruction process where the management does not change. Within the same management, I am just changing my business plan. But to implement the new scheme, I need some funds in the business. Now, how do I get funds? I am already a loss-making company. If I go to the banker is not going to allow me any amount of loan because I haven't been repaying the previous one also properly. So, there comes in a process where all the internal people, who are the internal people? Whenever I am talking about internal people, I am referring to the stakeholders of the company. Stakeholders of the company come together and they'll start funding the company with sufficient cash flows to implement the new business policy. So this is called as internal reconstruction. Your internal reconstruction happens with the stakeholders, either in the form of equity shares or your suppliers or your customers or your lenders, that is your providers of finance. All these people will provide sufficient funds for you to implement the business as far as your internal reconstruction plan is concerned. Then what happens in the case of a demerger? Demerger is a simple situation where I have one company, let's say A. It has two divisions, B and C. B is a continuously profit-making division. C was not such a profit-making division at all. But when A saw from an overall perspective, it was still making a decent amount of profit because B was making super profits, which were compensating the losses made by C. When they started analyzing how to maximize their profit, they understood that maximum amount of the company's resources are invested into B since it was giving more profits. But no one really concentrated on the C division, which could also be bought into profits if sufficient amount of resources are deployed to it. So what they start doing, they'll put this C, they'll transfer this C to another company, let's say X Limited. I'm transferring it to another company called as X Limited, where what we'll start doing is we'll start transferring all the net assets of only the C division, not the entire A. A is the selling company, but it does not get liquidated because A still has division B here. So only one particular division is transferred to the other company, and whenever it is transferred, now X Limited only has one division to take over. So definitely it will start taking care of the resources to be employed into the division C and start bringing out into profits. Okay. So this is basically your structure required for demerger. Normally sometimes there can happen a demerger where I have a profit making and a loss making company. There's one more company which has a profit making and loss making company. We club our net assets in such a way that my loss making company will become his loss making company so that he might try to do something from the loss making company. And his loss making division will become my loss making division. So that I will try to make some profit out of his loss making division. So normally a cross also happens. So this is a linear thing. There is also a cross thing that can happen in a demerger. Whenever we are talking about a cross demergers, cross demerger in a simple sense is, let's say A Limited has two divisions, P and Q. B Limited has two divisions, X and Y. Let's say for example, P and X are profit making and Q and Y are loss making. So what they'll start doing? They'll start doing this. Q transferred to B and Y transferred to P. They'll shift there, or they're just exchanging their loss making division so that they may bring up into profits. A's management wants to work with Y and B's management wants to work with Q, so that they are trying their level best to bring it out into profits again. Now this is your entire structure in brief when we talk about corporate restructuring process. I will not restrict the corporate restructuring to only this part. There can be further more as far as the corporate restructuring is concerned. But in a basic framework when we are talking about, it is only restricted to these four, you know, broad heads or verticals. Now, let's first discuss in depth about your accounting in the case of absorption. Whenever you're talking about absorption process, first of all, you need to understand there are two types of companies. One is a purchasing company, one is a selling company. And understand, even your amalgamation is nothing but double absorption. So once I understand what is the accounting for absorption, I can apply the same accounting as far as amalgamation is concerned. Similar situation even for external reconstruction, because external reconstruction and your absorption are in substance over form, they're very much the same. Correct? So we are talking about three things: absorption, amalgamation and external reconstruction. Now whenever we're talking about all these three topics, absorption, amalgamation and external reconstruction, first of all understand there are two companies. One is a purchasing company and the other one being a selling company. Now, whenever we are talking about a purchasing company accounting is completely ruled as per AS 14, accounting for your amalgamation. But selling company, when it talks about AS 14, is not applicable. Reason is simple. Selling company is getting liquidated. Why should a standard even talk about a liquidated company? It does not even have a going concern. So I'm not even taking this AS 14 for a selling company. AS 14, the standard is only applicable for your purchasing company. That's it. Then what does a selling company do? Selling company's accounting is basically as per GAAPs, generally accepted accounting principles. Now in a broader sense, if I have to understand the accounting, selling company has to get liquidated. That means the books of the accounts of selling company has to be closed. But in the case of purchasing company is taking over the net assets of selling company. So when it comes to the purchasing company, we need to start recording the net assets of selling company. We are incorporating into the books of purchasing company. So let's say I have a fixed asset of 100 rupees in selling company and 500 in the books of a purchasing company. Once I put together, once I bring the selling company's net assets into the purchasing company books, the net asset should start looking at 600. Assets of fixed asset of 500 plus fixed asset of 100 should become 600. Now this is your basic framework as far as your accounting is concerned. Let's first discuss about selling company accounting. Before that, just take it down. So yes guys, let's look into the accounting process in books 6 and the books of both selling as well as the purchasing companies. Easiest first is the selling company books. Let's say I have a selling company S Limited. Look something like this. I have an equity share capital of 100, reserves and surplus of 60, some other liabilities of 40, and my total assets came up to, let's say, about 200, let's put it as 180, and write some miscellaneous expenses, P&L debit balance or whatever it is, let's say 420. Now whenever I have a balance sheet like this for the selling company and the selling company has to be liquidated, then I have to cancel the entire balance sheet. How do I cancel the balance sheet? First, to cancel the balance sheet of selling company, let's try to first identify this. This is nothing but your net assets which get transferred to the purchasing company and in consideration of something called as purchase consideration. So what am I doing with this? I'm actually realizing this. So we'll open a realization account to identify the profit or loss on transfer of your net assets. Profit or loss on transfer of net assets to the purchasing company, let's say it is P. For the net assets being transferred, they are receiving something called as PC in return. What do we do now? We'll record entries. I have to cancel the asset. I have to cancel the outside liability because I'm transferring them. So, asset has a debit balance. Realization account debit. To asset and other liabilities account debit. Liabilities have a credit balance. I'm debiting it so that I can cancel it. Now, once the set of these two entries it was, then I have already transferred the net assets. I've cancelled the net asset from my book. For the return, in return of transfer of your net asset, I receive something called as a PC. And who is paying that PC? The purchasing company pays the PC. So, once the once you transfer, we have to first check what is a PC due. For the purchase consideration being due, why is he paying me PC? Because I am transferring my net assets. So, debit the receiver. Who is the receiver of the net assets? Purchasing company. So I'll record the entry as purchasing company account debit to realization account. Ultimately, my realization account after these entries will start showing some profit or loss. So realization profit or loss could be either situation. Who is the owner of the profits? In the case of a company, always profits or losses belong to equity shareholders. So basically, when I have profit, then I'll record the entry as profits realization show credit balance. So realization account debit to equity shareholders. If let's say I have a loss, I'll pass the reverse entry equity shareholders account debit to realization account. Once a set of these two entries are passed, then what happens is your equity shareholders, your realization account also gets cancelled along with your assets and outside liabilities. Assets and outside liabilities got cancelled to realization. Realization also got cancelled. But I have two new accounts in place. One is a purchasing company, other one is an equity shareholder. Let's try to settle the purchasing company. Now, why did you debit the purchasing company? Because its PC is due. Let's say you have settled the purchase consideration. How can he settle the PC? PC can be settled in cash, or the purchasing company can pay shares, or they can give debentures or bonds or whatever it is possible. So your PC does not have any particular format. So such a PC, first thing, think from a selling company's books. Selling company books, whenever PC is paid, see, PC is paid by the purchasing company, received by the selling company, debit what comes in. So let's say I have got cash as PC, cash account debit. Let's say I have got shares, equity shares or preference shares in purchasing company. Or let's say I have got debentures or bonds in purchasing company. My purchase consideration settled by any manner, debit the receiver, credit the giver. Who gave you this? Purchasing company. Credit the giver of the PC. PC is paid by the purchasing company, so I credited the purchasing company. A combination of these two, if you observe, purchasing company debit, purchasing company credit, purchasing company got cancelled. Now what I'm left out is with this purchase consideration received from purchasing company. There are a few other items which are existing as far as your balance sheet is concerned. I can't sell equity share capital. I can't sell my results in surplus to someone else. I can't sell my miscellaneous expenses as well. Whatever you can't sell, I can't put it to realization account as well. So what we'll start doing, who is the owner of the reserve? The reserve owner is equity shareholders. Be it a loss also, even the owner now again is an equity shareholder. So let's transfer these reserves and share capital to equity shareholders. So we'll record an entry something like this. Equity share capital account debit, because it has a credit balance. Reserves and surplus account debit to equity shareholders. For miscellaneous expenses, equity shareholders account debit to miscellaneous expenses. Now combination of these entries have cancelled the remaining items in the balance sheet as well. Now what are we left out with? We opened realization, we closed realization. Again when we close, we got equity shareholders. Purchasing company got closed. What I am left out with is the PC. So I have two accounts possible. One is the equity shareholders account, one is the PC receipt. So the entire PC should be paid to the equity shareholders. So settlement to equity shareholders. We shall record the entry as debit the receiver, equity shareholder. Debit what comes in, credit what goes out. Whatever PC you got is going out to cash, to equity shares or preference shares and purchasing company. To debentures or bonds and purchasing company. Once you pass this entry, your purchasing purchase consideration and equity shareholders account both get settled. And at the end, you will see that the entire balance sheet has become a null balance sheet, zero balance sheet. All the accounts being cancelled. So, this are basically your entries or bare entries that you can observe as far as your selling company books are concerned. Take down the entries. Yes, guys. So we're not much concerned about the selling company books since AS 14 is not applicable. What we are more concerned with is your purchasing company books. Now here your AS 14 becomes applicable, and let's discuss this part. Whenever I'm talking about accounting in the books of purchasing company, I can split the accounting into two parts. One method of accounting being called as pooling of interest method. The other one being called as purchase method. Two methods of accounting which are prescribed, that is pooling of interest and purchase method. Now first of all, we need to understand when do I use this pooling of interest method and when do I use this purchase method. Always to decide upon this, you need to check for nature of amalgamation. My nature of amalgamations can be split into two. One is nature of a merger and other one is called as nature of purchase. And if I have to decide about this nature of amalgamation and then decide about your method of accounting, I can say that my method of accounting, if it is the nature of merger, then I have pooling of interest method. If it is a purchase method, then I have purchase method computations. Broadly, I can say that there are two methods and two natures of amalgamation. How do I classify something as a merger or a purchase? The simplest is the purchase, because it clearly says that it is something which is not merger. Anything other than being called as a merger, then I have to call it as a purchase. But to understand this purchase, anything to be other than merger, first of all, we need to understand what is merger. So let's see what is amalgamation by nature of merger. Whenever I need to call an amalgamation by nature of merger, I need to satisfy five conditions. First one, all assets and liabilities of selling company are taken over. Obviously, it should be taken over by the purchasing company. So the first thing is all assets and liabilities of the selling company are taken over. Second one, assets and liabilities should be taken over at book value. That means I cannot revalue the assets and liabilities when they are being taken over. They have to be taken over at their book values only. Third one, purchase consideration should be only in shares of purchasing company. Like we said, PC can be in any form. PC can be in cash, equity or preference shares of purchasing company, or debentures or bonds of purchasing company. But to be called as nature of merger, then your PC should only be in the form of shares. Shares include both equity as well as preference shares. One small exceptional rule which comes up here is that fraction shares can be settled in cash. Now what are these fraction shares? Let's say the purchasing company and selling company have agreed to pay 3 shares for every 5 shares existing. If I have agreed to pay 3 shares for every 5 shares existing, and let's say this particular company has, selling company has about, let's say 20,000 shares. No, not 20,000. Let's try to make it in a different way. Let's say the PC has been accepted at 2:3 ratio and I have 10,000 shares. So purchasing company is saying I'll give you 2 shares for every 3 shares held. Now how do I get number of shares received? If I have 10,000 shares, I'll get 2 shares for every 3 shares held. Now if you divide this, this will be 3,333. 0.3333. Can I have a 0.33 share? Not possible. Those shares are called as fraction shares, which can be settled in cash. Normally when a problem is given, this is what we check. We only check until these 3 rules. That's it. We don't go beyond the 3 rules until here it is sufficient. The remaining 2 points which we'll take up, the total of 5 points, the first 3 points are evident from any question. If you read through a question, first of all, you can understand whether all assets and liabilities are taken over or not, and whether they have been taken over at book values or not, and whether the PC is in the form of shares or not. This you can understand from a question. But the next 2 you can't identify from a question, where he says that at least 90% of shareholders in a selling company should be the shareholders in purchasing company. Now, a question will not have any details regarding how many shareholders have accepted and all that. So we have to always assume if these 3 conditions are satisfied, then the 4th one is obviously satisfied. And also the 5th one is satisfied, saying that purchasing company will continue selling company's line of business . Let's say the selling company is a cricket academy and the purchasing company just wanted that land. So they have went and acquired the entire selling company's net assets. They have got even that piece of land and they started constructing a building on it. So it doesn't make sense, because you need to continue the line of the business. If this condition is also not satisfied, I'll call it as a purchase. But even this condition is not evident in any question. No question will contain these conditions. First 3 conditions are sufficient to call it as a merger or a purchase. Got it? Now, how is it different when we are discussing about a merger, and how is it different when we discuss about a purchase? Now, in the books of purchasing company, when I'm talking about the accounting entries, the first entry that we need to consider is the net assets of selling company being taken over by the purchasing company. These net assets, I'll have multiple assets and multiple liabilities. So let's try to think that this entire net assets is a package, and this package is called as a business purchase. What you have purchased is the net assets, which is nothing but the business. I'm not trying to write down each asset and each liability individually. I'm writing it as one single name, that is business purchase. Debit what comes in. So we'll call this as PCDU entry. Debit what comes in, that is the net assets. Such net assets are represented by an account called as business purchase. Business purchase account debit. Debit the receiver, credit the giver. Who gave you these net assets? By selling company, but selling company is getting liquidated. So we have to give it to liquidator of selling company. Liquidator is a person responsible to collect all assets and settle the liabilities in the selling company and in the event of liquidation. So the entire purchase consideration is payable to this liquidator of selling company. Like I said, this business purchase is a package of net assets. Let's try to now break down the entire package now. So assets and liabilities taken over individually, let's write down. this is where we get a change. When assets and liabilities are taken over, here we have two entries, one for pooling of interest method and the other one for the purchase method. Now, how different is the entry? Let's say assets and liabilities are taken over. Asset is coming in, so asset account debit. Liability has a credit balance, two liabilities. This is coming from a business purchase, so let's cancel even the business purchase now because it was something which we have opened. It's a package of net assets. What basically happens is the entry is the same, but it is not necessary that your PC will be equal to your assets minus outside liabilities, because it is not necessary for your business purchase, your purchase consideration in the business purchase to be equal to the value of net assets. So the entry may not tally. When the entry does not tally, when I'm talking about pooling of interest method, under pooling of interest method, the difference will be transferred to reserves. We will see in detail how is it transferred to reserves. But simple, understand, whenever this difference of, whenever this entry has a difference, such entry should be adjusted to reserves. But whenever it is a purchase method, the difference should be transferred to either goodwill or your capital reserve. We get a goodwill. Goodwill is an asset. That means goodwill has a debit balance. So if my credit side is more than the debit, then I'll write goodwill. If my debit side is more than the credit, then I'll write capital reserve. One last entry which we have to see is the settlement of PC. I have to pay to the liquidator, so debit the receiver. Liquidator of selling company is the receiver. I can pay him cash. I can pay him equity shares, which will be called as equity share capital. Can be preference share capital. Can be debentures or bonds. I might issue them at premium, so I might even get securities premium as well. If I'm issuing them at discount in the debit, I'll write discount on issue as well. So this is your settlement entry. In broad, I can say that only three entries will explain what is the accounting in the books of purchasing company. However, we haven't seen how this reserve comes in and what is that goodwill and capital reserve. We'll discuss about that in detail. Take down till here first.
Yes, guys. One more important topic that we have to discuss about